there something after there's nothing to say.
Okay.
Hi, Charmaine.
Hey, Charmaine.
It's been a while. It's been a while.
I know.
Nice to get together
again.
Yeah, and then we have some questions that we have to answer
about a very important conversation
for our audience. Okay, so I've got the first set of questions, and then they've started off as of easy. So I've got name.
Oh, that's easy.
Yeah,
I'm Jennifer.
I'm Charmaine. When they graduated?
2017.
2018. Where they TC?
I train at RNT.
I train at JLC Advisors. And then, okay, so when did you apply for your TC?
Year 3, SEM 2.
Year 3, SEM 2. So it always takes me a while to remember because I had a lot of fun in my year 3 and year 4, but I think mine was sometime in year 3, SEM 2, and then I probably procrastinated until, year 4, SEM 1, and then that was when I went to it. Do it full steam and got my TC then. Yeah.
Thereabouts, yeah. It's thereabouts. All haze.
It's all haze, right? Yeah. Yeah. Were you specific about that timing for when you chose?
No, I wasn't specific. It was more of like when I felt ready, I put in an application.
Okay. And like people have different times when they feel ready.
Correct.
For the TC process. Okay. Let me see. Okay, so related question. So why didn't you apply at the same time as your peers?
I think I didn't apply. I guess I applied at different stages. So I first applied initially at the start after people finished their internships and things like that. Mm. But then after that, I also took a pause where I was like, I don't want to just get caught up in the whole rush and flood to just, spam, to just try to get any job that would give you an offer, because I thought about it, you also want to be in a job where that you really want, that you want to grow in, and that you want to train in, because it's called a training contract for a reason. So you just don't want to go into anywhere or even any practice area just because it's a big firm and it sounds good. You want to feel ready in your heart that this is the practice area I want to learn more about, or that will, I guess, help me be the kind of lawyer that I want to be in future. Yeah. So that's why I wanted to take time to think about it for myself, because at the end of year two, really, how much do you know, about the kind of lawyer that you want to be in future?
Yeah. So I know what you mean about wanting to take time off. I think I had that same realization also at the end of year two. I think year two, sem two is when people find, they often call it like the semester from hell. It's the toughest semester. It was that for me, and I realized at that point of time that my first 2 years passed in a haze, and I didn't really know what I had done or what I had achieved or what even my goals for myself then were. So the toughness of year 2 sem 2 was actually a good point for me when I stopped and thought for myself, what is it that I'm doing here? And I realized that I didn't have a good answer for that question. So I took a year off from law school to do a gap year. And I spent that gap year, trying out different experiences, interning at different places.
Yeah, I really remember when you took that gap year. In fact, I thought it was really amazing that you were brave enough to take that step to, I guess, take space to do things, to find yourself. And I was just wondering if you could share more about how this 1 year was useful for you in the future when you were applying for your TCs.
Right. So I think when I took the gap year, my parents were concerned. And the question they asked me then was, maybe the condition that they had for me was that I come back and finish law school at the end of the gap year. And there were also a lot of people who were giving me advice to use this 1 year to do things that would be useful for my TC, to do internships at the law firms, because during the gap year, people would be at school, and then that's where I have the opportunity to do, not do my training contracts, but do my internships at law firms. Because everyone will be in school, so now I have I guess your better opportunity to apply for internships, mm. and the law firms may actually have space. So people were advising me to use that time to do internships at law firms, but part of the reason why I wanted to take that gap year was because I felt like the conversations that were happening around me were always about internships, were always about training contracts.
Yeah.
And it felt like such a small universe.
Yes.
And it felt like taking the gap year to do more internships would just be, I mean, would not help me step out of that small universe. So I think those were very well-meaning, you know, advice that came from the people around me. But I think what I ended up spending my gap year doing was pursuing things that I was curious about. So at that point of time, I had read a book called Eating Animals by Jonathan Safran Foer, and that got me curious about the environment, about my relationship with the environment, with animals, what it means to eat animals, what it means for animals, you know, within the factory farming system. So I spent the gap year doing internships at NGOs that work with wildlife, with the National Environment Agency, with an environmental NGO in Chiang Mai, Thailand, because I was curious about my relationship with the environment and also how I could use a legal education within that context, with causes that I care about. So when I look back now, I think how I spent my gap year was pursuing the things that I was curious about, to answer the questions that I had about the world, about my place within the world. So the very long answer to your question is that I'm not sure. I don't think I went into it with a very clear idea of how, of doing things that would benefit my TC application. Yeah. But I think, you know, going out there to try and find answers about things that I was curious about, to satisfy my curiosity about the world, helped me realize that there's a much bigger world out there aside from TCs, aside from internships. And so when I came back and I looked at, you know, what my options were, the universe broadened for me, and TCs were one way that I could, one route that I could take to, you know, contribute to the causes that I care about, or to pursue things that I'm passionate and interested in. So I think that lessened the pressure of the internship TC process, and I was much surer about what I was looking for. And I think I brought a lot more of myself into that process. So it wasn't so much me fitting, you know, my interests into a CV that would be, you know, interesting or attractive to a firm, but me bringing my interests, my passions to the firm and saying, this is who I am as a person. Let me know if you think I'm a suitable candidate for your firm, if you think I'll fit in with what you're looking for in an associate, in a senior associate, and when maybe eventually with you know, I may have much longer
life
with the firm. So, you know, I mean, maybe that's a bit far. I mean, that's a long way to think, but yeah. I mean, just for a start, whether they think I'll be a suitable associate, and you know, that I think that helped them to evaluate me much better as a candidate, and also helped me evaluate the firm much better also, because I was surer what I could bring to the table, and I was sure about what I needed in an environment to nurture me and to feed my interests. Yeah,
I think in essence it's about knowing who you are, what you want to be, and I guess when you were saying about presenting yourself to the firm, it's also more about them seeing if you're someone that they want to invest in, because they are training you. I think whatever you shared also ties in with this next question, which is about how do you feel about the environment in law school, which places so much value on TCs? I mean, I think this is a question that kind of links to your story about taking yourself out of the environment. So what do you think?
I think I mentioned it. It felt like a pressure cooker. It was an environment that placed a lot of emphasis on training contracts, on internships, and it limited the conversations that we were having in law school, which was a shame, because I think we have very bright students who come in who are very interested about the world, who are very interested in finding out more about themselves, about the environment, about, you know, climate change, animals,
human rights,
labor rights. All these things are very interesting topics, and I think whenever I have those conversations with my friends, we always have such, you know, interesting conversations. But I think being in a pressure cooker environment where you're always wondering about the next milestone that you have to meet, right? So finding an internship for the next holiday, or making sure that you get your TC by year three, or there are always these timelines or these milestones that you're expected to meet. And so I think that limits the conversations that we sometimes have with our friends.
Yeah.
I remember once remarking to someone once that every season in law school, when you meet someone, there's always a standard set of questions that you have to ask, right? Yeah. So if it's like TC season, then it's like, where have you applied to?
And before that, it's internship season.
Yeah, internship season.
So like, what are you doing in June? What are you doing in May?
What are you doing in May? Where have you applied to? How many internships are you doing? Which firms? Have you heard back?
Yeah. But why isn't it like, how are you? Rather than, where are you going next?
Yeah, where are you going next? Yeah. So there are all these very standard things that expected of us at every season of law school.
Yeah, I think it was kind of sad that everyone placed so much values on TCs but less values on themselves, like who they are as a person, and it's about being caught up in the chase, the rat race, and I guess it's coming from a place of fear that this is the end. If I don't get that TC right now at a good firm, then that might mean that my career is over or something like that. But honestly, the TC is just the beginning of your career. It's not the end. It's just the first step in your journey as a lawyer. And there's so many more steps ahead beyond, I don't know, the first 6 months after you graduate and pass the bar. I guess now it's 1 year for TCs. And I think it's sad that we value, I guess, an object, or I guess this position, more than we value ourselves, which is, yeah, a bit sad. And sometimes you might see some people go to great extents to, I guess in layman terms, sabo other people just so that they can get the TC, which also goes to, I guess, my point about how people are actually devaluing themselves and the people around them in a bit to get this job that you'll only have 2 years later. If you think about it, most other industries, you only apply for graduate jobs when you're graduating. That's why it's a graduate job. And if you think about it, for us, we still have 6 months after we graduate where we're actually studying for the bar. So we shouldn't, I guess, feel so constrained or feel that the timeline to get a TC is in year two summer and year three sem one. If you're gonna be a lawyer, you would have your whole life to work at a law firm. And it might be prudent to take this time to also find yourself, to know what you wanna do. And so maybe you could even try non-law internships, I don't know, maybe at a tech company or even bank, finance. I mean, there's a whole universe beyond, I guess, the TC world, and it will be useful to take steps to, I guess, pursue those interests while you have time. I think we always think that we are running out of time, like, oh no, I haven't gotten my TC yet, so like time is running out. But actually, there's no TC deadline. Like, I had friends who only got it in year 4, sem 2, or even in Part B itself. So there's no real expiration. If you think about it, it's not like a university where you have an application deadline, so to speak. I think most places is also on a, where it's based on demand and supply and a needs basis. And I guess we all know that needs are always changing. And so you shouldn't feel so constrained as though that there's someone's timeline that you need to adhere to, ultimately it's your life, so it's your own timeline. And I think when you think about that, as Sharm said, there's really a whole universe beyond, I guess, the traditional route that maybe having 4 years in law school.
And I have a question here that actually right on your point. So what mindset do you have to let go of when embarking on this path that was different from what your peers may have been doing?
I think it's letting go of the mindset that success is whatever everyone else defines it to be, which could be obtaining a TC in year 3 sem 1 or year 2 summer. So, and it's letting go of the mindset that fastest fingers first, like, you know, the first one to get a TC is the one who has won it in life or something like that.
You know, that we're used to there being these milestones for us, right?
Yes.
So PSLE and then maybe O levels or if
A levels.
A levels, yeah. And then after you go to uni and then the internship is another milestone, the TC is another milestone.
Yeah.
So I didn't quite let go of a mindset as I gained, I think, consciousness over how I was moving through this process. I felt like, I think at the end of year two that I realized I had been moving on a track that had been placed there for me. I think it's probably quite safe to assume that everyone who's in law school probably, you know, did fairly well. But I didn't quite step out of my circumstances and ask myself, like, what is this thing that I'm working towards and what does it mean for me personally? I moved on that track quite smoothly. And because of how smoothly I was moving along that track, it never occurred to me to stop and take stock of where I was and ask myself, based on my personal values, based on what I know are the things that are important to me, what am I doing here and why am I working towards this goal? Right. So I think stepping away, choosing a different, well, I don't know if it's choosing a different path, but I think it's suddenly becoming, I think the year two, sem two was when I became conscious of the existence, even the existence of a track that I was on. And then questioning whether this was the right track and who it was that was laying this track for me. And then I think consciously deciding to take myself out of that space, the environment which I felt wasn't healthy for me in that moment, I think I gained a consciousness about what I wanted as a person, where I was within an environment, what were the influences that were operating on me. I think that taking ownership of that process, my decisions, and stepping away, I think that was the change that happened for me. So it wasn't so much dropping a mindset, but it was gaining awareness and taking back control over decisions in my life. And to be very clear, like, no one took away that control from me, right? I self-limited my options and I self-limited the possibilities. So, you know, there's like no blame really, but I think it was just like a confluence of factors where I had been through life, my life experiences that I self-limited my options in this way. And so rather than go through the process mindlessly, I think you owe it to yourself to think about what's important to yourself, what are your values, and to make decisions that are aligned with your values.
I guess it's about not living through life like on autopilot, or cruise control, but just reclaiming ownership and direction of your life. I think an analogy might be, everyone wants to go to Changi Airport to fly, right? But there's so many ways to get there, right? Some people think that the most direct and fastest route would just be if you jumped on the green line and like went straight to Changi Airport. But I mean, there's so many routes. You could even take the blue line, for example. But all roads also lead to Rome.
Yeah.
But it's also,
or Changi.
Yeah, Changi. Rome is kind of far right now. But I mean, it's about how you want to choose, and no one path is actually better than the other, right? Like, does it really matter when you end up at Changi, I guess? Or Jewel, in this case. So, yeah, I think that's a good point that you brought up.
But were there emotional struggles that you face along this journey.
Mm. And it's about enjoying the journey. And for me, I knew it was important to find myself.
Mm.
And I think the other thing was, what if I can't find myself? As in, what if I am lost, but lost in a world of possibilities?
Mm.
such that I don't really know which direction I want to go in, right? So I think that's another struggle. But then I think the solution is really to just take steps and to know that, hey, I'm just a student, so I'm still learning about the world. And it's really not the end if you take one path, right? So let's say I chose to take blue line, right? It's not the end, right? There's always an interchange. I always can switch back to the green line at Bugis. So like, it's really not the end. Like, even if you take steps in a certain direction, it's like, you know how Google Maps, if you take a supposed wrong direction or a longer route, it will just redirect you, and it'll just show you a different route to get to where you want to go. So I think it's really just take time for yourself to know roughly what you want to do, what you want to explore. And to quote my driver friend, he once said that there's no wrong routes in life, only shorter routes and scenic drives. So yeah, learn to enjoy the scenery. And part of enjoying the scenery is daring to do new things. I honestly, if I could turn back time, I would say, you know, do even more new things. Yeah, so actually law school is the time when there's so many opportunities. There's so many other kinds of internships that are open to you to explore. Even if you need to take a gap year to explore them, you should do them, because this is, you, I mean, people always say time is money, but you'll never really understand this until, I guess, after you graduate. A friend who did I guess an internship in the UN, for example. So I think what you might have there, it might not be paid, for example. It might you might only have a small like stipend and things like that. But but when you do it as a student, the opportunity cost is really a lot less. And I would say that people are also more willing to share with you. And you would also be more open to learning and have more exposures. And you also don't have to feel like, the only opportunities available are just the opportunities advertised by CFG, for example. But you can also look up certain opportunities that you like, and like just feel free to email them. Or if you think that talking to someone at CFG might also help you with your application, that's also something that you can do. I mean, the people at CFG are really quite friendly, and they are very willing to help you look at your CV and talk to you as well. So yeah.
I wanted to pick up something you mentioned. So you mentioned the slots are all taken up, right? That's a implicit assumption there, that the slots are taken up because 100% of slots, these are the 100% that you have, and these are the slots that are available. But that's limiting what the possibilities that are out there. There's a much broader universe of possibilities out there. And I think once you find yourself in a mindset of, oh, what if the slots get taken up? Right, then you realize that you're operating by someone else's terms. Like, there's someone there who's telling you that these slots are 100% of the slots. But things change. Demand increases, someone's demand decreases, another area of practice becomes more lucrative. There are other areas of work outside of private practice that that, you know, require students who have legal skills training as well. So when you know, when people say the slots are taken up, right, there is a sense that they're accepting terms that someone else has given to them. And that creates a lot of pressure and a lot of stress on themselves and also on their peers, because everyone gets sucked into that conversation about, okay, there are like five slots, right? And who's gotten those slots? When you've gotten those slots? That's
a very limiting view.
That's a very limiting view.
And I think that's a good point. I think someone once said to me also, It's about applying for a job is about knowing your worth and knowing your value. And I think that ties in with what you said about basically not playing by the rules of someone else's game, or I guess defining yourself by someone else's terms. And I think the other thing to think about is that we tend to have a very fixed mindset about things. We have a fixed mindset about our own value and our own potential. And sometimes we are very tempted to define it with the number of rejection letters that we receive. But I don't think that is how we should measure our worth, because does it mean that if a dean's letter gets rejected, then does that mean that they're lousy? No, obviously it does not mean that, right? So it's about knowing your worth, knowing your value, and knowing what you can bring to the table, and knowing that what you're applying for is a graduate role. So we're all starting out from, I guess, as I said, the first step from square one. So at an entry-level role, and with everyone not having done this before, how much can you, I guess, really bring? As in, I'm saying that you can bring a lot and there's a lot of potential, but I think you should also see internships more as a chance for you to evaluate whether you enjoy the day-to-day of a role, rather than just seeing it as a chance to impress someone, right? It's as much about you interviewing them as them interviewing you. So during internships, it's basically you seeing, looking at culture and looking at the day-to-day, because you might be very enthused by the academic complexities of certain issues, but you might realize that in practice you don't focus so much on those academic practicalities. But there's much more, I guess, complex practical considerations and other kinds of things that you deal with in practice, and maybe that might not be your interest. So this would be the perfect time to, I guess, find out more about the role, make friends with the ASOCs, not to impress them, but so that you can actually understand more about them as a person first, and also maybe to understand a bit more about what they do, how they find life, and I guess maybe what they might have told themselves a few years back when they were in your shoes. And I think the other thing about what you said about seeing it as a limited amount of slots, I think that's something that we feel pressure is doing, because people say like, oh, this person got this TC here, so that means we cannot apply there anymore, you know, that kind of thing. But honestly, that's because we see it as being fixed in this present moment, in this present month. But bear in mind that everyone's applying starting to apply 2 years in advance for a job, and a lot of things can change in 2 years. I mean, look at yourselves, you're graduating in 2 years, so just as you're changing in 2 years, the how like how many people are in a certain role, whether a new department is being formed, and of course you have the quintessential people who quit their TCs to be JLCs. So there's always lots of market shifts and market changes, and there might not be a spot today, but there might be a spot tomorrow. So we shouldn't see it as so fixed and static, and should see it as a, I guess, more of opportunities for you to find out more about yourself and what you like. And I think that's what the whole TC process and interviewing process was as well. Because, I mean, you have to answer the question, tell me about yourself, times however many times you applied for a job, right? And that makes you really question, like, who am I? And who am I now? And who do I want to be, right? What do I want to hold fast to? And what do I want to change? And all this also goes into what do I want to explore more about. And I think the other thing I would say is that don't be afraid to continue pursuing your extracurricular or your interests outside of school, because I feel that all these things actually do help you in your career. So I think for me, I'm very into design and art and all, and tech, HTML, websites, stuff like that. And I felt that all those were actually very helpful in my interviews when I was applying as well. And I think also don't be afraid to do things that are different. As in, not because you want to be different for the sake of being different, but maybe on one hand, you want to make a difference. And on the other hand, it's just really something that you believe in. And you should really use law school as a chance to pursue your passions, because there's so much support and opportunities here. Like, the profs are so supportive as well. So, like, I think just don't be afraid to reach out. And also don't be afraid to, I guess, cold call or, like, send cold call emails to places that you might want to try working out at. Yeah.
And how do you deal with rejection? Because it's something that I think that's a tough part of the TC search. How do you deal with rejection personally?
Oh, okay. I think I deal with it by seeing it as, I think every interview is a process of getting to know yourself and getting to know the role that you are applying for. So I think I see rejections as good because then they tell you, I guess, a bit more about what you want and what you don't really want, and it's about knowing your worth. So you don't see rejections as meaning like, oh, I must have said something wrong in the interview. Maybe it could just be they didn't value something that you said in the interview. So that's why it goes back to knowing your worth and staying true to yourself. And if the person is rejecting you, then it just means that there was something about what you said, and maybe it's something about who you are that maybe might not have been a good fit in the firm culture in the long run as well, right? So you're actually, I guess, avoiding a minefield there, which is good for you because you want to be at a place that values you when you present yourself for who you truly are at the interview. So but ultimately I think it's also knowing that when you're rejected, sometimes it's not that you're necessarily like lousy or something like that. It could be maybe they wanted someone who had taken certain subjects, for example. Then, I mean, that's fine, right? Then if that subject is really your interest, then in year three when you take that subject, then it would just make you a better candidate for the next interview, right? I think from the so-called failed interview process, you might then find out a bit more about what firms might be looking out for as well. And then those are things that you can take into account when you think about how do I want to grow and develop in the next semester, the next season of life as well. So, yeah. And I just feel that, I guess for me, I just saw it more as, I guess, a chance for God to show me that, okay, this is not where I want you to be. And that I think, like, better things are waiting for you out there. I think there's that. Although I would say that I was not like this at the first rejection. But I think sometimes you also know that sometimes you can tell from like the people that they accepted, for example, that maybe it's fine, right? So maybe it's a firm that only wants to hire first class honors. But that's also fine, right? Because I know that I'm not defined by my grades, right?
Yeah, I feel like the rejection, to pick up something that you mentioned, the rejection tells you as much, I mean, probably tells you more about what that firm stands for, what they value, and what you present at the interview is a very small part of yourself that is probably also very performative, based on what you think that person is looking for. So, taking their rejection to be a statement of your value of statement of who you are as a person, how good you are as a lawyer, how good you are as a law student, how good you could be as a lawyer, is going to be a very bad yardstick for that. So it probably is going to be a bad, it tells you more about what that firm is looking for, what they value. And so I've always found any rejection to be more of a statement of the person making the rejection than of myself, because I know what I bring to the table might be very different on a day-to-day basis. It's going to be a performance. It's going to be my performance of myself at the interview. Statement of who you are as a person.
Yes, correct. Yeah. It's basically just reflective of their hiring needs and their hiring focus, right? Rather than your value as a person. I guess this ties in with this question, which is about ultimately what did the TC process mean to you? I guess from the whole pre-application process to retention and afterwards in practice too.
So my route was a little bit windy.
Scenic drive.
It was a scenic drive. It was a scenic drive. When I first applied for my TCs, there were a lot of things that I was pursuing and that I still am pursuing now.
Yes.
That may not necessarily relate to private practice.
Yeah.
So for me, when I first applied for my TC, I wasn't too concerned about the brand that that the firm had. What I was looking for was a solid training. Get called to the bar and get my training as a lawyer, so that I can contribute to the causes that I care about. So I did not apply to the brand name firms, because that wasn't quite what I was looking for when I was applying for my TCs. I put in a couple of applications. I heard back from one of the firms. I went for an interview and then I got an offer. And so that was a very clean process. I basically took the first offer that came from the first interview that I did. And, but this was by that time very late in the process of applying for TCs already. And I don't know whether I should have, you know, applied further, should have looked more. But at that point of time, I knew, it was very clear to me what I wanted from my TC, and that was to get my training in, you know, a place where the people are friendly. I feel like the quality of work is good, and get my training as a lawyer, and that was good for me. I didn't need to be branded anything, because that wasn't the brand wasn't something that I place particular value in at that stage in my when I was applying for TCs. So the training process, I think I think everyone says that training is very different from training and practice is very different from law school, and I think the training was that for me. It was very different from law school. It was very different from being in a classroom in law school.
Yeah.
But what I had done in law school was also to do the legal clinic modules.
Yes.
So I was with the Legal Aid Bureau, I was with the Singapore Art Museum, helping them with their in-house legal needs.
Yes.
I did a couple of the legal skills modules, like negotiation, mediation. And I think that all that practical training, being in a work context, knowing how to speak with people, knowing how to find my place in a working environment where you know, sometimes people are busy and they overlook you. It's easy to overlook an intern, easy to overlook a trainee, easy to overlook an associate if you're not taking up the space that you should be taking up at the table. So I think doing those practical modules in law school outside of the classroom taught me how to take my rightful space at the table, taught me that even as an intern, even as a trainee, I shouldn't be sitting behind. Like, I should be sitting at a table if there's space at the table for me, right? So I think training was that times 10. It helped me put into practice all these skills that I picked up through the more practical modules that I did in law school. So I think having a very clear idea of why it was that I wanted to be training at this firm, and having my expectations, my own expectations very clear to myself, I think helped me make the most out of my training experience.
I think to pick up on something you said earlier, you knew that you wanted to have good training. So how do you know that the place that you were accepting the offer from had good training? Like, how do you tell? Because if you don't know many people, how do you figure that out?
So honestly, I probably wasn't I think the best way now that I would tell juniors, the best way to find out about whether a place offers good training, and good training can differ from person to person. So
practice area to practice area.
So I think the best way is to speak with someone who is working in that area, and find out from them, you know, why it is that they've chosen this area. What is it that they do? Yeah. What, you know, as well, find out about that person personally, right? Like what kind of person they are, and yeah. whether, you know, you think that the place might work for that person but may not work for you, right? Yeah. So it's, I think speaking with the person is probably gonna give you the best sense yes. of whether, you know, that place is going to offer training that's going to be good for you. Yeah. So not just good in a vacuum, but yeah. good for you specifically as a person with your needs, your interests, your values, your personality. I didn't do all of that for my my TC process, so I'm not like the model example. I think for me, it was going out to the interview and then speaking with the partner, and then I like vibed with him, and I enjoyed the interview, yeah, which I think is always a very good indicator yes. of when
you're having a conversation.
Yeah, when you're having a conversation, yes. right? And that was how I decided to take up that TC with the firm that I trained with. But I must say the due diligence wasn't done that well. But I vibed through with the partner, and I think that was that was how I decided. But I would say for juniors, you know, speak with people who have been
doing that. But sometimes it's hard to find people who have done it. So it's also hard to do your due diligence, But yeah, I guess sometimes, I guess the minimum should be maybe you look at the cases, the methods that they've worked on, and see if that's something that you're interested in learning more about and training in. Because at the very least, that would be the kind of work they would be exposed to.
Yeah.
So at least you should know whether it is something that you want, right? Yeah. So, I mean, I think that was what the TC process for me. Like, I think it meant finding yourself, finding the direction that you wanted to work towards. So I think what was helpful for me was also an exchange when I could, they also had something similar to a LAMP mentorship program. So they paired me with a lawyer in London, and she, I think it was really good because she also gave me her insights about working overseas, because she didn't work in, I guess, the city that she grew up in. She was not from London originally, and I guess how the process was like for her, and what she looked out for, and she even introduced me to people who worked in practice areas that I was considering exploring. So I think that's the other thing as well, you know, talking to seniors about what their day-to-day looks like. Because I think taking corporate modules in law school, for example, is very different from actually running a deal. You might not enjoy the day-to-day of it. So I think it's good to know not just about the issues that people deal with, but what does dealing with the issue look like on a day-to-day basis, and seeing if that's something that would drive you every day. Because ultimately, your TC and your eventual career will be a place that you'll be spending most of your life, most of your time at. So you would hope and you would want it to be somewhere that you like. Someone's cup of tea is someone else's nightmare, right? So I think it's about finding what you like, and also knowing which aspects of the job that you like, right? Because for example, in school you might study about, say, maybe family law. You might think that the interests is very interesting, the issues that you deal with and things like that, but practice could look very different from that as well. So that is actually the value of internships, to see what the day-to-day is like. And this is where you also have people to talk to actually ask all the questions that Shams talked about earlier. So it's really about finding yourself, finding your way, and figuring out where you want to go, and knowing that there's always a U-turn if you want, or you can always turn right, turn left, wherever you want to go. Yeah.
Out of questions.
Okay.
I think the final, there's one more. Like,
on the piece of paper, write down a note to a junior who is feeling lost and confused and does not know what exactly they want to apply for. Read out each other's answers.
Okay.
Well, that's awesome.
I can think of time.
Okay. Thank you. Piece of paper, write down a note to a junior who is feeling lost and confused and does not know what exactly they want to apply for. Read out each other's answers.
I feel like I'm back in law school.
I know. I'm glad I get to read like a piece of your heart.
Aww. Okay. Should I go? I'll go first.
Okay, sure.
Mine will be much faster.
Indeed.
Dear you, you must feel as though you are lost in the crossroads of life. Don't worry. That just means that you are lost in the world of possibilities. If you feel lost, that must mean there are different options, directions, and things you are considering and evaluating whether you must pursue. Well, then you should go ahead and explore each of them, for that's what you have right now in this season, time and opportunity. And that also means there's a universe of opportunities waiting for you to find them and to claim them for your own. Mm. You're in a unique season of exploring and adventuring with the freedom to define and chart your own journey. Email firms and companies in the different areas you're considering.
Mm-hmm.
And no, I don't just mean in law firms. If you're interested in other things, say tech, art, music, design, talk to people in those areas you're considering pursuing. And if possible, land an internship in the areas you're considering. As they say, the regrets we have in life are the chances we didn't take. Take this chance, seize the day, and explore the universe of opportunities. Looking back, my non-law internships were the ones that I loved and that helped me find myself and figure out which general direction I wanted to explore even after my TC. If you feel lost at a crossroads, that might also be because you feel pressured to choose only one route and one path. But you don't have to choose only one path. You can choose the general direction you wish to pursue, explore, and seize the chance to concurrently try out new things and calibrate your level of commitment and involvement in each area you might wish to pursue. After all, being an artist and a lawyer is not mutually exclusive. It's just a calibration of the level with which you pursue each interest. You may also be feeling scared because you might feel like
You may feel scared because you may feel like once you take the step.
You may also be feeling scared because you may feel like once you take this step, it's a point of no return. But that's not true. It's your journey and you're free to choose and chart your own course and change direction if that's what you want. Remember to enjoy the journey of exploring. Bon voyage, dear traveler. Excited for the adventure you choose to take.
Yes, I'm very excited for the adventures that you choose to take. And now it's my turn to read out Sham's letter. Hey, I know it's confusing and painful and scary. I'm glad you're feeling all of these things. This means you're alive and asking the difficult questions about who you are and what are the things that are important to you. That's fantastic. What I want you to know in answering these scary and confusing questions about who you are and your place in the world is, do not let someone answer those questions for you. Take all the time you need to answer these questions.
Make sure the answers are
your own. But make sure that these answers are your own. This is your body. This is your mind. This is your life. Don't ever settle for someone else's answer for yourself. Be brave. I promise, finding your own answers is so worth it.
You make That's it so amazing. Much better.
That's amazing, Shams. Yeah. And I'm glad that we have found our own answers and are still finding our own answers.
Yeah, we're still finding answers and answers change.
Because life it's an open-ended question, you know? It's not like MCQ, although sometimes law school makes it like that. It's as though you have to choose either option A, B, C, or D, or else you're screwed. And if you choose option D instead of option A, then you failed the test. But that's not life. Life is an open-ended essay question. And each milestone is just the end of one chapter and the beginning of the next chapter. So we're excited to see how all of you write your own journeys. Thank you.
I think we have last words.
Oh, you have last words.
any last words?
I don't know.
I guess those were your parting wishes for those who are watching. I guess mine would be
let us think about this question and we take that.
Words for our audience.
I guess I would say dare to be different and dare to make a difference. After all, in the end, don't define yourself by how someone else has defined their own journey and how someone else has defined what their version of success looks like. I think you should set your own values and measure your own life by your own values. So yeah, seize the opportunities that you have now and try something new and see how life unfolds. That's all from me.
I think my last words would be that looking back now, I think the times that were most emotionally painful, that I felt the most stuck, were also the moments in my law school journey and my training contract journey where I experienced the most growth. Looking back now, I think those are the points where I was in a lot of pain because I was asking, I was forced really to ask difficult questions about where I was at in that moment, what I was pursuing. And those questions were very difficult and very painful because the answers didn't seem to be like what everyone else seemed to be finding for themselves. And I'm so very glad for the people that I had in my life at that point of time, because I realized that I made so many assumptions about what people expected of me, about what I had, what I needed to do. And I think once I freed myself from those expectations and I made space for myself to have those conversations with people around me, I realized that we were all grappling with the same questions. And it was okay for me to make space for myself, to take time, take the scenic route if I needed to find my answers. And I think the painful, the scary, the confusing moments were actually the moments that turned out to be the most personally fulfilling moments in law school and in my training contract journey for me.
That's true. I guess that's why they call it growing pains for a reason. Yeah, but the growth is just so worth it. And if I had to turn back time and do it all over again, I guess I wouldn't trade that pain for something else. Because sometimes, I guess, pain just awakes you to a whole new world.
And it's I think people like Jen, who really can be vulnerable and
real
in front of, I think, meet a world of a difference.
So support your friends too on their journey, because you never walk alone.